God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Have they been selected in accordance with the canons of this church? And do you believe their manner of life to be suitable to the exercise of this ministry?
We certify to you that they have satisfied the requirements of the canons, and we believe them qualified for this order.
My brother and my sister, will you be loyal to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of Christ as this church has received them? And will you, in accordance with the canons of this church, obey your bishop and other ministers who may have authority over you and your work?
I am willing and ready to do so, and I solemnly declare that I do believe the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the Word of God, and to contain all things necessary to salvation, and I do solemnly engage to conform to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of the Episcopal Church.
Dear friends in Christ, you know the importance of this ministry and the weight of your responsibility in presenting Cara, Ellen, Modisett, and Samson, James, Mamour for ordination to the sacred priesthood. Therefore, if any of you know any impediment or crime because of which we should not proceed, come forward now and make it known. Is it your will that Cara and Samson be ordained priests?
Yes.
Will you uphold them in this ministry?
We will.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us.
On the Holy Spirit.
unchangeable power and eternal light. Look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. In the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the thresholds shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me. I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from Ephesians. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I speak to you in the name of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a seat. Before I begin, it's important to say I was originally asked to preach at the ordination of William Yeagle. Raise your hand or something, let people know where you are. There you are. Because he graduated with Cara and Samson, and we had this dream that I would be a part of preaching at their ordinations. Three people who, the seminary educates every seminarian, but we don't miss every seminarian who graduates in quite the same way. We pray for all of them. But I have heard by name, these three people already in just the first semester that they weren't with us, that they and one or more of their gifts are missed. By name, Cara, William, and Samson. So there's an honorary recipient of this ordination sermon, and it is Reverend Yeagle. Apparently, there's a congregation that, like, I don't know, needed a priest or something for Christmas. I mean, I've heard that's a thing. So he got his stripes a little early. And it was no surprise at all to hear that the church that he now shepherds was busting at the seams at the birth of our Lord for Christmas. I feel the same way about the communities that Cara and Samson are already a part of. And as of today, we'll serve in the particular and peculiar order as priest. We know what these three people can do. Not because there's a list of things that they can do, but we know how God has used them in our community. It's not always as someone who teaches at a seminary that I miss students, not because I miss teaching them, but because I miss being taught by them. But the job of a preacher is to not just reflect on the people who are being ordained and on the world into which they are being ordained. It's also, it's important to look at the scriptures, and I'm just taken right now, though, because it starts even in the opening hymn. If you were just visiting from outside Christianity, you might just sort of read through this bulletin and see it's not exactly a tourist advertisement for the world. But it does. It really starts in the song, Father, what they do forgive, yet we hoard as private treasure all that you so freely give. And if that was kind of a downer, but you got into the descant and got over it. Isaiah reminds us, I mean, he says something humble, which is nice, that he's a person of unclean lips. That makes everyone who's a jerk feel better. But I live among a people of unclean lips. Now, when somebody says that, it's one thing, but when a prophet who talks to God about what the world is really like says that, that's not good news. Then you go to Psalm 43, the psalmist says, defend my cause against ungodly people, deliver me from the deceit and the wicked. And even in the psalm that we just heard sung beautifully, thank you for your gifts, which are ordained by every ear who hears them. Thank you, choir. Even in that psalm, there's a little hope here. Send out your light, begging God and your truth that they may lead me. Bring me to your holy hill, to your dwelling. In other words, the only way to get out of the wickedness is to escape. It's like escape room and God gets you out. If you thought the epistle, some of you are like, the epistle usually just talks about, you know, your neighbors and you can move on and get to the gospel. But no, slow down here. Even the epistle says, in the world we're blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery. That's not you, right? That's your brother-in-law. By their craftiness in deceitful scheming. They watch a different cable channel than you. And then our Lord, this dominical phrase, that Jesus had compassion. He looks on the world, he doesn't get excited. He looks on the world and has compassion because we are a harassed and helpless group of sheep. Sheep without a shepherd. So again, that doesn't make you, I mean, if there's a SpaceX on another planet, that doesn't make you want to get on a rocket and land on this one. But you'll notice that in almost every one of those readings is also the word light. How creation began and how creation will end. Light. That's our hope. God did warn us early on, maybe it's not a warning, it's more of an explanation, as to why we live like this, why we act like this, even when we want to have a good day. It's New Year's resolutions, right? Most of you have already broken them. But we hope. We make them. We make them because we hope that there will be more light than dark. But God says something in the beginning to help us not get lost. And it's not about produce in the tree. Don't know. No. Sooner than that. God creates a human person and then says something profound to help us understand the world in which you have been ministering, that you will just begin to minister as priest today. God said, it's not good for a person to be alone. Now, as someone who was a high school chaplain for many years, I actually think alone is a lot better than trying to chaperone pairs. And groups. On the other hand, how many of you, looking into your own hearts, don't mark as some of the saddest times in your life? Not necessarily the financial, the health, the unemployment, the uncertainty. The things that hurt us most when we look at the stained glass windows that tell the story of our lives are the times where we were the most lonely. The Bible may not be history, but it is true. So God told us that we were not only better off, more things could get done by being with others, but that we are made by nature to be in relationship. It is not good for us to be alone, says the triune God. When we are in relationship with one another, we come closer to the image of God. One as we can be one. The problem, though, is human beings. Some of my favorite theologians who are actually long dead, people who are known to have been kind of grumpy, there's usually a phrase about them that they loved humanity, it's people they didn't like. Because the truth is, we are a mix of the light from the very beginning. Let there be light. That's also the annunciation of our creation, not just light itself. Let there be light. And yet, all of human history is an experiment of God-given light mixing with human-chosen darkness. For those of you that believe you do not choose darkness, feel free to go to the reception early, leave some food for us. I'm not speaking to you. There's a phrase from ancient philosophy, homo homini lupus, you Latin scholars. Every man or every person is to another person a wolf. When you go before Jesus, you know, even before what we have as the ancient texts of Israel, there is this abiding belief that we are animals. Again, obviously that meant that there was a prom and chaperones back then. I get it. It, by the way, you haven't chaperoned the prom, just turn on public television and watch some nature show of any species. But that we are, in fact, animals, and it is part of our, not just gifts, maybe even our destiny, to defend ourselves, to compete with one another, to play king of the hill, even as young children. This is the great threat. Not to morality, but to joy. That every other person is to another, either you're my lunch or I'm yours, so I have to start acting to get a good outcome of that. Every man is to another a wolf. Aristotle knew this was not true. Again, and we learn more about what Aristotle thinks because St. Thomas Aquinas in the 13th century rescues a lot of the writings of Aristotle that have been lost over the medieval period. There's a reason they're called the Dark Ages. And a lot of Aristotle that gets dusted off is from Thomas Aquinas, who teaches what we have at the beginning, let there be light, when God created humanity and saw we were good, creation is good. Aquinas hands these teachings back to the world and says this great sentence in his Summa Theologica, which is a six-volume set of books. He wrote when he was 26. I try not to get threatened by that. But a beautiful phrase for all baptized living, the laity, deacons, priests, bishops. Humans are social by nature, not by choice. Now, what we have to understand as we try to understand the world into which all of us who have come through the font and are now lights of Christ in the world, all of us have to understand that this truth, that we don't just need each other for things. We need each other because we were created, knit together, and the only thing that has ever pulled us apart is the free will we were given to enjoy being bound together. We can also use it to unbind. It's not that we take the tree of knowledge's fruit necessarily. It's that from the very beginning, we do whatever we do alone. And the loneliness comes in and can strangle our joy in ways that cancer can't and often doesn't, even death. I did you might know as their last rites recently, and the man was singing Amazing Grace with his adult children, later in the day with his grandchildren. Death had already lost its sting and it hadn't even arrived. But there was a community around him, a good death, the great prayer of the church for all of us. But by the 16th century, if you ever had to take a survey course, you know our dear friend Thomas Hobbes. There's a cartoon that refers to him. He did his best to deal with the animals that we are and said, the way to form a community is by, you might know this, right? The social contract. He absolutely believed that every person is to another a wolf and said, the way we get around that, what he called a fact, is that we could convince people to obey laws only because we could convince them that if they did, no one would hurt them. This is against all biblical teaching and Christian teaching from the beginning, that we are in relationships by nature and that life is about discovering our connections, not making them. Enjoying the learning that comes from them, not figuring out how to start them. Coming into the 20th century, most of you have experienced this whole story of philosophy that I've mentioned in that book, The Lord of the Flies. This idea that all you have to do is put even children on an island, and when just take the chaperones out, just give them a couple of days, and all of a sudden they've got on war paint, they're attacking one another, and by the end of the book, they've even killed one of their own. So the question for you today, all of you, everyone in here, do you believe that every person is to another a wolf? Do you keep your Christian faith in one part of your life? Because you love what it says about humanity, but the reason you love it so much is at the end of the day on Monday morning, you think the best way to live and invest and vote and purchase land and raise children is to basically tell people to watch their back. Christianity is sort of like a seasoning on the rack. You know, you pull it out, paprika or something. Oh, hot sauce. You add it to what you call wisdom. You got to watch your back, take care of yourself. If you don't think that this idea hasn't entered both the world and the church, think of the 20th century. I was preparing a couple for marriage, one of your responsibilities ahead, and I asked them in addition to scripture, which they actually weren't that into scripture, but Grandma Episcopalian was paying for the wedding, so I could tell they were kind of dragging their feet on like the Bible stuff. I read it in the Passion of Corinthians, which they had never heard. But that's not at all uncommon for a 25-year-old in America. Oh, that's lovely. Yeah, we'll use that. I said, was there any other reading that, I was trying to get to know them, that sort of inspired you? And one of the two in the couple said, can we have a reading from The Man in the Arena? The Man in the Arena was a speech given by Teddy Roosevelt. His birthday was yesterday, actually. Have any of you ever heard of that, The Man in the Arena? You've probably heard this phrase. It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. Remember, this is Teddy Roosevelt. He'd been hunting big game in Africa for 6 months and came back, and actually, this is the first thing he said. So just picture that setting. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deed, who knows great enthusiasms, great devotions, who spends by himself his blood on a worthy cause, who at the best knows at the end the triumph of high achievement of himself. And who at the worst, if he fails, at least he fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither knew victory nor defeat. I don't know that we want to read that in your wedding. Trying to use the language in the spirit of the Feast of Pentecost, the language of my community, I said, your partner here, let me just ask, how did you hear that? To which the partner said, oh, that's my favorite quotation too. So that's why they thought they should be married. I, on the other hand, then saw two parallel lines that go forever. Because this hymn to individualism is not exactly an invitation for two to become one, unless one of them is winning. So this is the inheritance we have in this country. Individualism is the thing to be celebrated. You could even be injured as long as you are making sure that you win. One of my other favorite places you can find the DNA of today, the DNA of today, was from our friend Sigmund Freud, who told the world, and he, of course, being one of the most important voices in philosophy, though he was not a philosopher of the 20th century, this is the world that we've been born into, most of us. Men are not gentle creatures who want to be loved, who at the most can defend themselves if they are attacked. They are, on the contrary, creatures among whose instinctual endowments is to be reckoned a powerful share of aggressiveness. As a result, their neighbor is for them not only a potential helper to their own ends, but a sexual object, but also someone who tempts them to satisfy their aggressiveness, to exploit his capacity for work without compensation. He likes to use people without their consent, to seize their possessions, humiliate them, to cause pain, to torture, and to kill the other. Yes, says Freud, homo homini lupus, one of the truest phrases in history. Who, he says, in the face of his experience of life and of history, will have the courage to dispute this assertion? I don't think the average person who visits your church will scream that at you on the receiving line, but I have had it happen more than once. This is why Jesus says, in this world you will have trouble. Also, we hear in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus says, go, behold, I send you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. That's the same word in the Latin translation of the Bible, lupi, for wolves. But do remember that there is that great vision of the prophet that at the end of time, the wolf will lay down with the lamb. Don't miss that. We will not always be at war. We will not always be St. Paul who says, I can't do what I want to do, and I want to do the things that I'm not doing. Cara and Samson and William, you have chosen to go into a world of wolves. And because it has been so many years and decades and centuries in this culture, the chances that you do not have wolves in your own heart are not very good. Our whole culture in this country is an experiment of the social contract. Are we really safer assuming that the person next to us is not our neighbor to be loved, but another animal who threatens everything we love? So how is this experiment going? I think there are two studies that can answer this question for us. Many of you who work in the social realm know that for the last now 15 years, psychologists and psychiatrists and sociologists have just admitted that the Western world is living in what's called the loneliness epidemic. Have any of you heard that phrase before? The loneliness epidemic. Incredible amounts of research being done on the effect of loneliness on the human body, also on society, on everything else, but just literally on your body. Right now, look at your own hands. That we've done studies of what any loneliness you've ever felt actually does to you. And one of the many ways to categorize the metrics of this is that loneliness, over time, is as detrimental to your physical health as smoking 15 cigarettes a day. That's the same health impact as being lonely for a day. Think about that, deep loneliness. I've said in many of my classes at the seminary that in the United Kingdom, where they actually, you know, have the national healthcare system, so that they really want to manage costs and really figure out what needs people have, there is a minister of loneliness in the UK because of the price of the healthcare problems that come with loneliness. That they've realized it is a national crisis how lonely people are and how sick it is making them. They have a minister for loneliness. But there's another study, and here brings the light. It started in 1938. I'm sure some of you have heard of it. A TED Talk that talks about it has 33 million views. It's one of the most viewed TED Talks in history. And it is the study, not of loneliness, but of happiness. Some people call it the Harvard study. They took 268 Harvard sophomores in 1938. And the funny thing, in that class, John F. Kennedy was in that class. Ben Bradley, the editor of the Post, was in that class. But they just picked a random class and decided that they were going to study that group for the rest of their lives. I think there's 16 of them left in their late 90s. Now, by the way, it didn't take them long to realize this is not the average group of people. I am a Harvard graduate, so I can tell you that this would be a great study of all kinds of neurotic behavior. But every 10 or 12 years or so, the grant and the study spread to include their spouses and then their offspring, and then parallel studies were done in urban environments to have inner city youth. Now there's about 5,000 people that are part of the study, up and down the social class, education, things like that, gender. They added women, because remember at the time Harvard was only men, so they've added women since then. And now we have this huge, one of the longest studies on health and happiness ever. And it should come as no surprise to us, people of joy, to hear that having a deep set of relationships, even if it's only one, is more predictive of longevity and happiness than cholesterol, blood pressure, diseases, things like diabetes, stress, anxiety, depression. It goes on and on and on. The number one predictor among now thousands of people over decades, in some cases 80 years, is how connected you are to other people. It overcomes almost. It's more important than genes. It's more important than the study that they did of how people are nurtured, so both nature and nurture. These things are literally challenged, lessened, or even completely overcome by having relationships. But the great sadness is the world into which you are going as priests, into which you will preach the gospel with both your words, which is all of us as baptized people a job to do. But with your bodies and your lives, we are a people who are made for one another, So Augustine was right. We are made for God, and we are restless until we rest in God. But you know what Christianity also adds to that? We are made for one another, and we are lonely until we rest in one another. Why all this time talking about how the world is, maybe a few ideas about how we got here, and how the truth of the love of God breaks through scientifically about who we are, is these three names, William, Cara, Samson. They are missed in different ways at Virginia Theological Seminary for more or less the same gift. They form and feed relationships. That is who they are. And they are also demonstrations of other things I've said. The threat of health, the threat of political violence, the threat of differences, the massive inequality in income. All these things that should have brought out some pretty jaded grown-ups. And these three love to sing. They love it better when other people sing with them. They make music. And of course you're thinking, oh, you mean Cara, because she's like the musician? Well, yes, first of all, yes. But to see Happy Birthday, and I've seen it. I've seen William and Samson sing Happy Birthday to a classmate. And there's not an Ave Maria by a highly paid singer that's better. They love people. And people, look, that's the answer. The loneliness is killing us. The lie of America of individualism is killing us. Literally. And not just us, but across the world. It is such good news for me to read that loneliness is the world's problem. I don't rejoice in it, but today, two more priests are going to show up on the scene who can't help this whole thing. We could have a hurricane, God forbid, happen right now, and this service didn't, and this afternoon, they would be loving you. I trust me, no different with this. Today, the church says we see it. It doesn't give it. It's like the Wizard of Oz. You don't go to the wizard to get courage. The most he can do is say, here is a symbol of the world. Today, the church gives you the symbol of who you have always been. You destroy loneliness. Satan hates you both. This is a grumpy day for Screwtape. Someone's going to get fired. Samson had a habit at the seminary. We would call it a gift. Do you know Samson took a picture, not just of every senior sermon, and then posted it on Facebook. In fact, you knew, like, oh, if you didn't get a picture of that senior giving it, don't worry, because Samson, he was going to post it. He would walk around with his camera. He had a smile ministry. He would literally like take pictures of people just to send them. Man, not of many words, which is very rare in seminary and the Episcopal Church. He wants to give love. He wants to give life. Cara. I will never forget seeing her play the accompaniment on a piano as we were in the COVID, you know, that whole world that sort of crushed so much of community. But I remember we had a professional opera singer who gave a concert to the whole seminary, and everyone talked about how wonderful she was. But when you got to the concert, it was Cara who was sitting on the, accompanying her on the piano. And for those of us that know Cara, we just smiled and thought, this is a picture, her Tiffany stained glass window forever. I will give my gift that the world hears someone else sing. And I will both lead and follow. I will be impressed and I will rescue. And I will do all things to the glory of God. I know you're going to be good priests. I also know you have wolves in you. But I know you're going to be good priests because I'm an Episcopalian with an evidence-based faith. But the devil loves when ordinations are coronations. The devil loves when ordinations are fashion shows. Because that can distract that today, if you are in this room, it is the will of God that you ask yourself, Where am I going? For whom am I living? The famous Jewish philosopher Rebbe Nachman said, if you are not a kinder person tomorrow than today, what need of you for tomorrow? What is God calling you to do today? They're taking an actual physical step up here. They're wearing white. You know why? Not because they're priests, but because they're baptized. And the white is the symbol of their baptism. For those of you who are baptized, they're you. Don't think of what makes them different than you today. That's the devil. Think of what makes you and them connected in mission and in meaning and in destiny. When you see them walk up here in the white, that's you. Now watch what they do in courage and ask yourself, what am I going to do? What would happen in the world if we went into a church where there weren't speakers and listeners, where everyone who was baptized is on a mission? And ordinations are the days that we get an actual image of people saying, yes, yes, yes. Dietrich Bonhoeffer's first line of his autobiography was, the call to follow Christ is the call to come and die. Now that we don't want to put on the door of the church. But that's a reminder that you, I don't know what your name is, come tell me after the service, you are here today, not just to be a participant here, but to find the vow that you will make and you will take, not next week, now. Whisper it while they take theirs. Once upon a time, there was a brother and a sister. It was Halloween. And they both went out to gather all their candy. When they came back, the older brother looked down and saw his sister had more candy because he'd been eating all along the way. So he didn't have much, and his much younger sister had all, she was like rationing it till Christmas. So the other older brother tried to say to himself, how am I going to get this candy? By the way, it's completely irrelevant that I'm a younger sister and have an older brother, but he finally figured it out. Through his whole childhood, he'd had a collection of marbles, and everyone in the family knew it. What they didn't know is he'd grown out of it. Does that make sense? Like, he knew where they were in his closet, but so he decided, this is what's going to work. He goes to the closet and says, I'm going to give her the marbles and trade for the candy, because I actually don't even like the marbles. So as he's walking in the hallway, he looks down and he sees there's a couple of marbles he actually thinks are cool. He'd forgotten. So he takes two or three out, puts them under the pillow, and goes up to his younger sister and says, I have decided it's time for me to trade this invaluable. Here, take it. And she knows this is trading up. She's young, but this is her chance to show the world, just because I'm younger, I know a trade up. Gives them all the candy. Take the perishable, as St. Paul would say. Give me the imperishable. She takes the marbles. He leaves. He's walking down the hallway, already eating all the candy, laughing. He pulled one over on her, and he hears her jumping up and down in the bed. She's naming the marbles. But after about an hour, her room gets real quiet, and he realizes she's fallen asleep. But he can't sleep. In fact, he's up all night. Because he's haunted by one question. Did she give me all the candy? It is a Christian and Jewish truth about covenant. We are not protected by what we keep back. All we are doing is training ourselves to be skeptical of everything. Part of having the gift of faith is giving up on the safety of skepticism. You are going to come up here today and give all your marbles. Yes, lose your marbles. It's not always a bad thing. And thank you, both of you, for reminding me as I watch you walk up to look at what marbles I'm still holding, because I think they're safer with me. And the doubt and the distance and the loneliness that comes with not trusting the world. Don't train yourself in loneliness. Today, lose your marbles. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified and justified. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. Acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
My brother and my sister, the church is the family of God, the body of Christ, and the temple of the Holy Spirit. All baptized people are called to make Christ known as Savior and Lord, and to share in the renewing of his world. Now, you are called to work as a pastor, priest, and teacher, together with your bishop and fellow presbyters, and to take your share in the councils of the church. As a priest, it will be your task to proclaim by word and deed the gospel of Jesus Christ, and to fashion your life in accordance with its precepts. You are to love and serve people among whom you work, caring alike for young and old, strong and weak, rich and poor. You are to preach, to declare God's forgiveness to penitent sinners, to pronounce God's blessing, to share in the administration of holy baptism, and the celebration of the mysteries of Christ's body and blood, and to perform other ministrations entrusted to you. In all that you do, you are to nourish Christ's people from the riches of his grace and strengthen them to glorify God in this life and in the life to come. My brother and my sister, do you believe that you are truly called by God and his church to this priesthood?
I believe I am so called.
Do you now, in the presence of the church, commit yourself to this trust and responsibility?
I do.
Will you be guided by the pastoral direction and leadership of your bishop?
I will.
Will you be diligent in reading this, in the study of the Holy Scriptures, and in seeking the knowledge of such things as may make you a stronger and more able minister of Christ?
I will.
Will you endeavor so to minister the Word of God and the sacraments of the New Covenant, that in the reconciling love of Christ may be known and received?
I will.
Will you undertake to be a faithful pastor to all whom you are called to serve, laboring together with them and your fellow ministers to build up the family of God?
I will.
Will you do your best to pattern your life in accordance with the teachings of Christ, so that you may be a wholesome example to your people?
I will.
Will you persevere in prayer, both in public and in private, asking God's grace both for yourself and for others, offering all your labors to God through the mediation of Jesus Christ and the sanctification of the Holy Spirit?
I will.
May the Lord, who has given you the will to do these things, give you the grace and power to perform them.
Amen.
God and Father of all, we praise you for your infinite love in calling us to be a holy people in the kingdom of your Son, Jesus our Lord, who is the image of your eternal and invisible glory, the firstborn among the many brethren, and the head of the church. We thank you that by his death he has overcome death, and having ascended into heaven has poured his gifts abundantly upon your people, making some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry and the building up of his body. Therefore, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, give your Holy Spirit to Cara. Fill her with grace and power, and make her a priest in your church. May she exalt you, O Lord, in the midst of your people. Offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to you. Boldly proclaim the gospel of salvation, and rightly administer the sacraments of the new covenant. Make her a faithful pastor, a patient teacher, and a wise counselor. Grant that in all things she may serve without reproach, so that your people may be strengthened and your name glorified in all the world. All this we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Therefore, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, give your Holy Spirit to Samson. Fill him with grace and power, and make him a priest in your church. May he exalt you, O Lord, in the midst of your people. Offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to you. Boldly proclaim the gospel of salvation, and rightly administer the sacraments of the new covenant. Make him a faithful pastor, a patient teacher, and a wise counselor. Grant that in all things he may serve without reproach, so that your people may be strengthened and your name glorified in all the world. All this we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Samson, receive this Bible as a sign of the authority given to you to preach the Word of God and to administer His holy sacraments. Do not forget the trust committed to you as a priest of the Church of God. Cara, receive this Bible as a sign of the authority given to you and to preach the Word of God and to administer His holy sacraments. Do not forget the trust committed to you as a priest of the Church of God. Let us now welcome with our applause the two newest priests in the Episcopal Church.
Wow. Well, on behalf of the vestry, the congregation, the staff of Trinity Episcopal Church Staunton, we welcome you. We hope you feel welcome to the bishop and Ken and Mark, to friends from Grace in Lexington, to wherever you have come from in the background of Samson and Cara's life and ministry. Thank you so much for being here. For those watching from home, we know that you're there, and we also appreciate you joining us in worship for this special occasion. I have two things to say. I'm going to start with the easier of the two, which is there's a reception afterwards. And my guess is you'll be hungry. So it's in McCracken Hall. There are two ways to get there. If you want to be the first in line, don't cross the labyrinth. You can just go down the steps, and those front doors to McCracken Hall are open. You'll be right there, right close to the food and beverages. If you need to make a stop along the way, and I think you know what I mean, you can cross the labyrinth and go in those double doors, and the restrooms will be right in front of you. There are also restrooms on the next floor up and the next floor below in that same spot. We hope you'll stay for the reception. Third thing, we will share Holy Communion, which of course is a joy, but a little confusing. So here's what I'm going to do, Bishop, with your permission and preemptive forgiveness. I'm going to use words that we all understand, which is to say that when you come to communion, of course you can receive the bread, just cross your hands, you know how to do that. Then when it comes to the chalice, you have the choice of either sipping, dipping, or skipping. And what I mean by that is that you don't have to receive, because we know that the grace of Holy Communion is fully present in both elements of the sacrament. So if you only receive the bread, you've had all the grace of communion, so you can skip by crossing your arms. If you don't feel, if you'd like, you can also sip from the common chalice. Or if you'll hold on to your wafer and make it very visible for the chalicist, you can dip into a much smaller chalice. Okay? Just when you come up, go to the far and then work your way in, and I promise we'll get to you. And then you just come back this way and return to your pews. The ushers will guide you. It should be fine. Thus concludes my report.
Well, good morning, church. And I say that because this is one of the best moments of being a bishop, and one of the best moments I hope you feel of being the church, because here we are, all orders, most importantly, all of you lay people who have come to bless Cara and Samson and William. I'm glad that Patricia, thank you for your words. It drew this little cohort together because they have been a blessing to our diocese in many ways before. They even aspired to ask the Commission on Ministry if they might be called into this ministry. And then they blessed, obviously, people, Virginia Seminary, and all the places they go. And now we are looking forward to you blessing this diocese as priests in the church. And one of the ways that you can help them bless their work is contributing to their discretionary fund. So the collection that is taken in this morning will be divided equally among both of them. And so you can put money, especially all those bigger bills that you keep hidden in the back of your wallet, in the plate, or you can follow the directions in the bulletin where there are some QR codes and things and some ways to give online too. Ascribe to the Lord the honor, do his name, bring offerings, and come into his courts. Thank you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready the creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being. Sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image, and you taught us to walk in your ways. But we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. Sin and death, and to reveal the riches of your grace. You looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your Holy Spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation, to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
and see that God is good, the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you for feeding us with the holy food, the body and blood of your Son, and for uniting us through him in the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for raising up among us faithful servants for the ministry of your word and sacraments. We pray that Cara and Samson may be to us an effective example in word and action, in love and patience, and in holiness of life. Grant that we with them serve you now and always rejoice in your glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the heart of those who make the journey with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind.
And the blessing of God who made us, who loves us, and who travels with us, be with you now and forever.
Thank you.
us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks.